call a meeting of the Higher Education and Career Readiness Policy and Finance Committee to order. We do have a quorum and an exciting hour and a half, maybe. I say that because we have some guests with us today. I'd like to ask Representative Daniels to introduce his guests.
Thank you, Chair Nornes. I have two guests from Bemidji, been lifelong friends, Al and Judy Killian, down to see how this place works. And just to thank you for coming down and being a part of it.
Ask them to stand or wave. Welcome. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Yeah. One other item here that's sort of a surprise, I guess. We've been given a box of candy anonymously. And so we're going to ask the page over here to break it open.
Yes.
I don't know if there'll be enough.
We'll make do.
And then we're going to just pass it around the table.
Let's start with Nick.
Start with Abigail. Start with Abigail. One piece. That's all you get.
Just one?
I don't know.
Bite the pest.
So there's some risk to the chair here because normally I'd get the first pick. Oh, no. No.
Smart move.
Oh, my. This is really hard.
I know. Yeah.
Well, okay, I'll take this one.
Okay, good choice.
Thank you. Okay. Now, while that's going on, again, we thank the mysterious donor who, as I look around, I have no idea. So, but again, thank you very much. It's very appropriate. It's Valentine's Day, by the way, isn't it? Yeah. At this point, I would like, Representative Jessup.
Chairman Nornes, we have a birthday to celebrate today.
We do.
Miss Haley, Representative Haley has a birthday today.
It just gets better and better, doesn't it?
So may she have two pieces?
As long as I've got mine, she can go ahead. Yeah. I guess we don't sing in this committee. So.
No.
But thank you. Thank you for joining us, being on this committee, and happy, happy birthday.
Okay.
Now, I think we're to the point where we need to introduce some folks that have come to be with us. House File 889, I move. What's that? Yeah, we're going to do the minutes first. Let's go back and I need a motion to approve the minutes for February the 8th.
So moved.
Okay, I didn't see who said that. Voices all sound alike.
So moved.
Okay, thank you. Representative Omar moves on the minutes of the 8th of February. Any questions, corrections, discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, minutes have been approved. Thank you very much. Now, as I started to say, House File 889 is before the committee, and the motion will be that it be laid over for possible inclusion. And now we need a testifier, if we can find one, in the audience. Anybody can help me out? It's my bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Welcome to the committee.
I'm Larry Pogamiller, Commissioner of Higher Education, and Nikki Oliver, who is our government relations person. And Mr. Chairman, thank you for authoring it, and I think Representative Pawlowski's authoring also, as I understand it. And this is the governor's proposal for post-secondary education this year. And he, as you know, has increased the amount of funding in the last few years, and he wants to continue that trend because of the cuts that were made in the decade previous. So it's a $318 million biennial request. There was $1.4 billion available. He put about $600 million into K-12 and about $300 million into higher ed. So in terms of his total investment, you can see, not unusually for governors, emphasis on education. The idea with the $318 million is to provide an opportunity for every Minnesotan to get to their best fit post-secondary institution, the one that best meets their aspirations. Increase college affordability. You've done a lot in the last few years to help on that. He'd like to continue that trend. And also to reduce student borrowing. And I think mostly the direct aid to students is how one would view the investment there for those three purposes. And then, as is pretty traditional for a Democratic governor, the governor feels very strongly about the public institutions in post-secondary education, and he's making a $255 million suggestion there. And that's, of course, to support our training and workforce activities through post-secondary and our research and development activities. Just to remind us, there was a 47% decline in state funding between 2000 and 2013. That was not unusual to Minnesota. Many states were reducing because of the national economy reducing their investments. Minnesota's was a 47% decline. We have made up some since 2013, about 20% of that, which is about a fifth of that decline. Because of the decline, we saw significant increases in tuition and debt for post-secondary students and families. Tuition more than doubled, tripled in real dollars. And as you know, the debt load's increased, although the last 2 years, that has been stabilized. And we are now sixth in average debt for a baccalaureate. And we are fifth in terms of, in the nation, fifth in terms of the number of students who actually borrow. So about 70% of our students who borrow. We used to be fourth in average debt, and we used to be third in percent. So we stabilized it, I think, would be the way to argue it.
Can I ask a question? Just going back to the decline in investment, I'm not sure how that's calculated. Is it based on the percentage, in other words, percentage of the state budget, or is it actual dollars you're talking about? Because the budget has gone up substantially since that period of time.
Correct.
So I'm just wondering what, how that's calculated.
Mr. Chairman, this would represent the decrease in the piece of the pie that post-secondary is getting. So it's against post-secondary investments. And I think we're roughly at about 1.1 to 1.2 billion a biennium for both Minn State and the U of M right now. And that is down from about 1.5 or 1.4 billion. So it's been a $200 to $300 million decrease in real dollars.
Okay. Thank you.
The challenge we face, as you all know, more and more people feel the need, and I think the economy feels the need for people to get some kind of post-secondary attainment, either a certificate or degree. And we have widening gaps by our low income and students of color, 30 to 40% gaps in attainment. Whereas our population of Minnesota is going to become much more diverse. So if we don't turn that around, if we don't get better attainment by our students of color and low income students, we're simply gonna choke off our economy because we will not have enough people to do the work at the level that's required. As I mentioned, the governor's making two investments, one in the public institutions, and I'll very quickly just show the Minn State total is $150 million the governor's recommending. Minn State had asked for $178 million, and the governor has a slight, has only, instead of $143 million for campus support, he has $125 million. That's the major difference. There were also some grants to reduce disparities that the governor did not include that Minn State had asked for. So they had asked for 178, the governor included 150 million. The University of Minnesota asked for 147.2, the governor has 96.8. He supports the same that they had for core mission, but his research or Minn Drive request is about a fourth of what the university asked for. They asked for $32 million. He's got $8 million in his request, and that's for the cancer research portion of their priorities. And he does not have the Bell operating dollars in his budget that the university had requested. Then moving quickly, and I know you're having both of them in, so I just was going to go over that very quickly. We certainly would answer questions if you had any, but So now the Office of Higher Ed, that this slide shows, and that's for fiscal year 18-19, the first column, it's just not on there, and in fiscal year 2021. So the request is for $71.2 million. The bulk of that is in need-based aid, $62 million. And then there's some other items that we will go through in some detail. In the packet that you were handed out, I'm now going to move the state grant. There's a sheet that looks like this. We don't have a slide because we didn't think you could see it. This sheet shows for 2000 to 2016 the recovery of family incomes. And there's a lot here, but the bottom line is it basically shows that families with incomes over 82 or 83,000 have recovered from the economy's dip, whereas family, in terms of purchasing power, whereas families below about 82 or 83,000 have not fully recovered yet. This is our basic argument why we think you should invest in the state grant. It's targeted need-based aid to families and students who are least able to pay for the increasing cost of post-secondary education. The next sheet is a sheet that shows, as Ms. Fergus is describing the investments, it shows, we don't have that on a slide, but I believe this was handed out also. It shows county of residence of people who, of students who receive straight grants. So the blue one is, if you're from Dakota County, you'll show up in the Dakota County number regardless of what Minnesota institution you go to. The green sheet on the back shows where the money actually ended up. So that's the college it's at. So if you're a Saint, we have a student today from St. Paul who's a state grant recipient. On the front sheet, he shows up in the St. Paul County, Ramsey. On the back sheet, he shows up at Winona. He shows up because that's the school he's at. So that's the difference between the two maps. Mr. Chairman, let me turn it over to Ms. Fergus to describe the investment in need-based aid.
Well, welcome to the committee. Just ignore me.
Thank you, Chair Nornes. For the record, my name is Meredith Fergus. I'm the manager of financial aid research for the office, and I'll be going over the state grant provisions within the governor's budget. The state grant program has been proposed an increase of $62 million. The goal is to maximize state grant effectiveness, improve economic equity. It would increase grants to all current recipients, which is 82,416, and it would provide new grants to approximately 6,400 students. The proposal has three levers for change. The first lever is to change the living and miscellaneous expense allowance. Currently, in law, it is set to the federal poverty level, and those numbers, as of last Friday, were $9,045 for fiscal year 18 and $9,135 for fiscal year 19.
And that's the poverty level for a single person for 9 months.
Correct. The governor is proposing to invest an additional $35 million in living and miscellaneous expense, essentially by moving the LME from federal poverty to 106% of federal poverty. It would add approximately $550 to that federal poverty level. It will increase grants to all current recipients, and just from the LME change alone, it would benefit an additional 3,500 students who would receive grants. The increase would average $120. But full-time students will see a full increase of $275. The second lever for change in the governor's budget is a change to the assigned family responsibility. This is the amount that a family is determined to be able to contribute to the cost of college under the state grant parameters. In law, it is set to a percentage of their federal contribution, which is parent contribution for a dependent student, or the expected family contribution for an independent student. And those parameters are listed on the slide. The governor would lower those parameters by $500. So it would be a dollar reduction in those grants. It would cost approximately $38 million. And it would increase grants to about 42,000 students. Those are the students who have an assigned family responsibility greater than zero currently. And essentially, it's a dollar for dollar change. Each dollar that you reduce the assigned family responsibility means they get $1 in additional state grant funds. So it is a dollar for dollar change. It would add approximately 2,900 new recipients and it does increase grants by $500 per recipient for middle-income families, and that is essentially families with incomes from $35,000 to $85,000. In addition, the third parameter is to help students who are not well-served by Pell Grants. Currently, state grant in law requires the office to subtract a Pell Grant even if the student does not receive one. This includes students who have not completed a high school diploma or GED and maybe Minnesota Dream Act recipients. Under the governor's proposal, we would change that law to subtract a state grant only when Pell Grant is actually received, and it would estimate it to cost approximately $2 million for the biennium. In terms of what those mean, the visual on screen in the yellow shows you where we're applying. We're increasing the LME, so we're pushing grants up on the top of the screen. And then with the AFR, we're pushing that blue-green kind of line out, which is where the additional state grants would come in. So under current law, a state grant would range from zero to about $5,834. Under the new parameters, that would increase to $6,109 for the families affected at the Twin Cities or at a private institution. For a student at Normandale, it's similar changes. We're pushing up the state grant line and we're pushing out the AFR. So state grants at Normandale are currently estimated to be about $0 to $1,437 for next year. This would increase them from zero to about $1,712. Are there any questions about the state grant proposal? Otherwise, I'll turn it back over to the commissioner.
Any questions?
Ms. Chairman, just to sum up on state grant, the emphasis is to help basically that group between $35,000 and $85,000 in income, and that's based on our analysis of recovery of family incomes on that sheet that I showed you. This is a group that is particularly susceptible to debt because they're kind of caught betwixt and between. And if we can put, for many of those students, we're talking $725, $750. That's maybe $750 they may not take out in debt. In the governor's budget, there are four statewide initiatives that we are going to have people briefly testify on. The first is homeless college student emergency grant matching funds. And I'm going to ask Ms. Sabajani, I probably butchered that, but ask her to join us. And she will describe what they do at Alexander Tech with a Bremer fund that they have had over the years, where they basically are able to give one-time money to students who find themselves in an emergency. Their car broke down, they can't get to school. They lost their home and they need some rental assistance. And what the governor's proposal is to basically provide some state matching funds to institutions like Alexandria so they can broaden their efforts.
Well, thank you. Welcome to the committee, and please identify yourself for the record, please.
Chairman Nornes, representatives for the record, my name is Muzamba Sivajene, and I am the Intercultural Program Management Specialist at Alexandria Technical and Community College. It's indeed a great honor to come before you and put a face to the situations that we have faced. I have several examples of students who, without a $200,000 Bremer grant that we received over a period of 2 years, would have actually dropped out of college. So I will tell a story of one student who was a law enforcement student all summer. He became homeless at the beginning of summer. All summer he lived in his minivan. It only came to my attention once fall started that he was homeless because his friend came and told me. And so at 10:30 at night, I went and found him parked outside Walmart doing his homework using his car light. We were able to house him give him permanent housing and get him back on track, and he graduated last May. We have another who was a domestic abuse situation, and we helped her to escape her home with her three children, gave her a grant that was able to give her new housing. We have another student who was homeless and had mental health issues, and so did not know how to advocate for himself. And again, through word of mouth, we found him and housed him. A lot of the students that we have helped have only needed about $500 to get them back on track and get them, you know, going back to school. They walk 4 and 5 miles because they know that by graduating, they're going to change their tax bracket and they're going to be able to lead a better life. So it is imperative that we find a way. We don't have that Bremer grant anymore, and so we are reaching into our own pockets many times to help them, to feed them, clothe them, and get them situated. We've started a food shelf on our campus to try and alleviate that, but we would really appreciate having this situation looked at, because it's not only Alexandria, but it's all colleges across Minnesota. Thank you for
Thank
your
you.
Time.
So before the Bremer grant, you did not have a program? Is that
No.
what started it, or did you have something before that?
We had what is called an emergency loan.
Okay.
So the students had until the end of the semester to pay that back. But we found that in many cases, the students that struggle academically are not able to work as much to pay that off. And so once the Bremer grant came in, that really relieved us. So we have the emergency loan again, but that's still not enough. It's
So how long was that grant for? Was it just a dollar amount that the Bremers gave you?
Yes, and they gave it to us over a period of 2 years, and it was $200,000 each year, and we used every last coin of it. We had housing, emergency, and we paid students money so that they could reduce the amount of time that they went to school. I mean, they went to work, mm-hmm. so that they could focus on their studies. Yeah. And we got about a 97% graduation rate as a result. So.
Questions from members? Well, thank you very much. Sounds like a very worthwhile program.
Thank you
and
very
it's
much.
Probably just the tip of the iceberg.
Right.
I'm guessing others have.
Absolutely.
You're not the only college that has
no.
that problem. So.
No.
Commissioner.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, the focus here would be to provide some matching money to campuses so that they would have to go out and get some of their own money from a funder. And it's meant to be temporary money. It's not meant to be long-term money for these students. I want to introduce to talk about his use of the state grant, Elijah Norris Holiday. Elijah, there he is. And he's just going to generally talk about his experience with the state grant. I'll let him say where he's from and what school he goes to.
He is prepared. I see he's got a laptop. This should be. We're looking forward to this. Identify your name for the record, and then proceed.
Okay. I'm Elijah Norris Holiday, and I would like to first start off by saying good afternoon, Chair Norris, and committee members. I'm Elijah Norris Holiday, again, from St. Paul, Minnesota. I am currently a junior at Winona State University, and my major is public administration, with a public administration, political science with a minor in communication studies. I graduated from Como Park Senior High School in 2014. I decided to go to attend Winona State University because it was very local and allowed me the opportunity to come back home on the weekends to help my father, who started a small business in order to kind of help our family gain a little bit more money. But I remember when I was younger, my father used to always come home. In the middle of the night, he used to wake me up, and he used to always tell me how much he loved me and how he wanted me to work very hard in high school so that I can make my way into college and to help my family out in ways in which he could not. And that kind of stuck with me throughout my whole high school career. I really tried very hard to do well in school, to get certain scholarships, and to really try to make a difference, at least in my immediate family life. So I'm here today, standing before you, representing students from my state universities who are struggling with the growing problem of college debt. By increasing the Minnesota state grants, the state has given more money to students who wish to pursue higher education as a means to improve their overall quality of life. Receiving a college education is directly correlated with better health, financial stability, an increase in civic engagement, and many other compelling reasons to why to seek a college degree. The imperativeness of getting a college degree can simply be a matter of life or death, gaining poor, being poor and then becoming rich, and also for certain populations of people whose family may not have an established wealth in our society, it gives them the means to move up in the ladder. I also want to just make a note that even with the assistance from this state grant, I'll still graduate with $20,000 in debt, and I really don't know how I'm going to be able to pay for that debt as of right now, and I still have another year of college to finish, and I'm already at about 20 grand as of now. So this state grant has really helped me out in a lot of ways, and it will continue to help me out as I pursue higher education. I have every means to not stop at just a bachelor's degree. I want to go on to get a master's and also maybe a doctorate degree as well if I can afford it. So increasing the state grant can be very important to help me achieve those goals and many other students like me who want to really better themselves and better their lives and also better their families. With that, I would like to open up for any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for your presentation. And there's at least one member on this committee that would like to thank you for coming to Winona. I don't know if you've ever heard of Representative Pawlowski or not.
Yes, I have. Okay. He has a pretty good reputation at Winona State.
Yes, I bet he does. He does. Well, good. And you've chosen a career path that sounds pretty interesting, too.
Yes. Yeah. I'm really interested in pretty much working for the public, and I want to maybe hopefully open up my own nonprofit organization someday.
So. All right, very good. Thank you very much. Excellent.
Thank you.
Commissioner?
Mr. Chairman, then we have something called the Summer Academic Enrichment Program, which has a current appropriation of $100,000 a year. We'd like to increase that by $50,000. And did I get that right?
Mm-hmm.
And it would provide additional stipends. We have a waiting list, and it would provide about 70 additional stipends. We do not have a student to actually, do we have?
We don't have a student here, but I do have a statement from one of the programs of a student that participated in the Summer Academic Enrichment Program. We do have a director of one of the programs in the audience, Robbie Seam, and they work for the Minnesota Institute for Talented Youth. They're in the audience somewhere, I don't know where.
And then I think we will ask Asia, even though she didn't get this funding, she attended one of the programs through a different funding mechanism that she can tell us about.
Yeah. So one of the students currently a senior at Brooklyn Center High School. Her name is Mia Jones. She participated in the scientific discovery program over the summers, and currently she has received the Donaldson Science Award for 2017. So because of her participation in one of the SAEP programs, she was able to receive an award.
Hi.
And these are programs for like summer scrubs at Augsburg or science and math at St. Cloud State. And even though Asia did not get one of these grants, she attended the program where we send these grantees. So introduce yourself and tell them which one you attended and why it was a good thing.
Well, hi, my name is Asia. I'm from Patrick Henry High School, North Minneapolis.
Just to clarify, that Asia you said is?
Asia, yes.
Asia.
Yes.
One word? Yes.
Okay, so Maxwell. Asia. Oh. Maxwell.
Okay, that's all I was. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so I attended a camp at Wolfridge. I don't know if anyone knows about it, but it's a science program, and it really helped me a lot. It really helped my interest in science and, like, physically getting outdoors and learning science that way opposed to from a textbook or from sitting at a desk. It really makes a big difference. It just teaches you a lot about yourself and other people, getting those connections with your peers and all sorts of things like that.
Very good. Any questions of Asia? You're the second person that I've met who's got a name, Asia. That's very nice.
So again, these are grants, usually they're scholarships basically to junior and senior high students to go to these enrichment programs in the summer to better prepare them to get into the college that they would like to get into.
Actually, it's from 3rd to 11th grade.
3rd to 11th grade? Thank you, Nikki. This is why we have staff to remind us what we're supposed to know. The next program then, Mr. Chairman, is Governor has a $5 million investment in a teacher shortage licensing proposal, and it is aimed toward grants to higher ed post-secondary institutions to diversify those in the teaching force. We only have about 3.8% of our teachers of color out of our entire teacher workforce in Minnesota, and we're headed toward 30%, 35% of students are going to be students of color. And then there are licensure areas that we have shortages. There were 3,500 teachers hired in 2015 that lacked the necessary license or grade level licensure that they needed to teach in our high schools. So these grants to higher ed institutions are to do two things: to diversify the teaching workforce and to provide incentives for students to go into shortage areas. We have two people to testify today. They're part of a coalition to increase teachers of color, Violeta Hernandez and Paul Spies.
Welcome to the committee. Who's going to go first?
I will.
Okay. Identify yourself, please.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Thank you for the opportunity to comment on House File 889. For the record, my name is Violeta Hernandez Espinosa, and I am the Education, Legislative, and Policy Liaison for the Council on Latino Affairs. Today, however, I am here to speak on behalf of the three ethnic councils and the Indian Affairs Council in support of various interventions in House File 889, and particularly those relating to the shortage of teachers of color and American Indian teachers, an issue of priority for all of our councils. As state agencies, one of our main duties is to advise you, the legislative body, and the governor on issues of importance to our respective constituent communities. One of the consistent concerns for our communities, as has increasingly become for our legislative members, is the achievement gap, which is particularly pronounced for communities of color and American Indian communities. Over time, we have come to acknowledge that this is an issue that not only impacts these specific communities, but the whole of Minnesota, as we seek to maintain a competitive economy, skilled labor force, and quality of life for all Minnesotans in the face of changing demographics and an increasing number of retirees. In order to close the achievement gap, we must continue our historical commitment to educational opportunities for all Minnesotans, a commitment reflected in Minnesota's ranking as the second most educated state in the nation. As Minnesota adapts to changing demographics, however, the state's success will in part be ensured by implementing targeted interventions and approaches that address the specific needs of students of color and American Indian students. In reading House File 889, we are particularly pleased to see a number of interventions that directly address the needs of these students, among them the appropriations to College Possible, the Minnesota Indian Scholarship Program, and the state grant and work study programs. Another issue we are pleased to see addressed is that of the shortage of teachers of color and American Indian teachers. While Minnesota's student body is 31% students of color and American Indian, the 2017 Teacher Supply and Demand Report indicates that only 4.2% of teachers are of color and American Indian teachers. Research has shown that teachers of color positively impact student achievement, especially for students of color. By diversifying the teacher workforce, we are also creating role models for students of color and American Indian students. An increase in teachers of color and American Indian teachers would ultimately help alleviate the teacher shortage many of our school districts are facing. These are a few of the short-term outcomes. There are many other medium and long-term outcomes to the state as a whole. In House File 889, we would like to draw your attention to two interventions in particular that aim to address this shortage: the Teacher Loan Forgiveness Program and the Minnesota's Future Teachers Program. The latter specifically includes underrepresented racial and ethnic group teacher candidates and provides grants to programs and candidates as well as mentoring. As part of our goal to increase teachers of color and American Indian teachers, we support these types of targeted interventions. Thank you for your time, Mr. Chair, members, If you have additional questions about this particular issue, we are open to further discussing with you. And I'll let Paul enter.
Thank you. Any questions before we move to the next testifier? Right. And I think you are the next testifier. Identify yourself, too, for the record, please.
Chair Nornes, members of the committee, my name is Paul Spies. I'm with the Coalition to Increase Teachers of Color in Minnesota, American Indian Teachers. Our coalition formed in 2015, December, and with 40 people in higher ed institutions, public, private, University of Minnesota, Minsky system, and the K-12 schools. Since then, we got 730 members, 150 different organizations, school districts, higher ed institutions as part of our coalition, uniting around this issue. And we have a lot of different organizations agreeing with the bills that you're gonna be seeing coming forward from the coalition. So we're just here to say hi and in support of the governor's initiative to address this issue in his bill.
Well, thank you very much. Sounds like you've been working hard in that short time. So
thank you
very much.
Then,
Commissioner.
Then, Mr. Chairman, members, we have one more initiative, and then we'll go into the operations budget of our shop. And the last initiative is a $300,000 appropriation for a sexual violence prevention and response coordinator. We have two people who want to speak to this issue, Yvonne Cornuier.
I knew I was going to.
Canoyer and Carolyn Palmer, who are from the Minnesota Coalition Against Sexual Assault, MNCASA. And they approached the governor and lieutenant governor and suggested that the smaller campuses in Minnesota did not have the resources to properly do professional development and outreach for staff to prepare themselves for the changes in federal law related to sexual assault on campus.
Thank you.
All right, who's first?
I'm Yvonne Canoyer. I'm the Prevention Program Manager at the Minnesota Coalition Against Sexual Assault, and I'll be testifying. Carolyn Palmer is our Public and Legal Affairs Manager, and she's available to answer any questions that you might have.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah, thank you, Chair Nornes and members of the committee. We support the governor's request for $300,000 for a campus sexual violence prevention and response coordinator to provide guidance and disseminate best practices for colleges and universities throughout the state. Minnesota took a great step forward back in 2015 when changes to 135A15 were passed, and they really raised the bar on how colleges respond to, report on, and prevent sexual violence. Now we find colleges are really looking for guidance on best practices and policies that will work for their specific type of institution. We support having a state-level coordinator who can serve as a point person, coordinate policy, promote evidence-based practices, provide guidance on implementation, develop trainings, improve multidisciplinary practices, provide technical assistance, and work with us and others to really improve Minnesota's response to sexual assault on campuses. In our experiences, campuses really want to do a good job with responding to and preventing sexual violence, and they're struggling with the specifics. Especially some of our two-year colleges where a Title IX coordinator might be wearing two or three other hats. So they want to do what's right, but they don't necessarily know how, or they don't have the resources to figure out what's best practices. In 2016, MNCASA worked really closely with the Department of Health, the Minsky schools, the Minnesota Private Colleges Council, and the Aurora Center to convene a 2016 Campus Sexual Violence Prevention Summit, which was attended by over 300 people from 57 different campuses. And one of the focuses of that summit was to provide the trainings that are required under the new legislation, the changes to Minnesota 135A15. So we know that colleges are hungry for this guidance. We also know that colleges are under increased scrutiny from students and parents, by the media, and from the public for how they're handling and how they're reducing sexual assault on campus. So we believe adding a campus sexual violence prevention and response coordinator now is essential for fully implementing the improvements the legislature sought when they made the changes to 135A15 in 2015. So we believe this should be funded as soon as possible because campuses right now are in the midst of implementing this legislation, and so we really want to make sure that they're getting the best guidance possible. So we are available to answer any questions that anyone has.
Questions from anyone? Otherwise, thank you very much.
So, Mr. Chairman, that $300,000 over 2 years, $100,000 would be used to hire a staff person in our shop, so someone roughly in the $70,000 range plus benefits, and then a $50,000 amount to provide materials and outreach. And finally, we want to talk about our operations. And just wanted the governor's operating budget request, not only for our agency, but for others, is to try to basically hold together the increased pressure on the agencies that's taken place because of lack of funding in the last few years. And in post-secondary, our basic mission in our shop is to provide post-secondary opportunity and equity and attainment to serve the workforce. And if we don't figure out a way to have more of our students graduate with less debt, we're going to stifle our economy. We do just an overview of what we do in our shop, and I'm going to give you a breakdown of how many people we have. We manage and disperse need-based aid to about 100,000 Minnesotans. That's with the state grant, Indian scholarships, child care grants, GI Bill, work study, college savings plan. We manage a $540 million portfolio of low-interest debt, or loans that we give to students and families, called self-loans. We do prep outreach to thousands of students and families at the junior high and senior high level. We distribute over 400,000 publications annually for people looking for, they want to know what their post-secondary options are. We provide consumer protection, which we've seen in full force in the last 6 months with the closing of some of the colleges. We basically advise students as to what their new options are now that their college is closed. And obviously we also provide, we call colleges that are still operating on behalf of students if the student is having trouble with the college with regards to finances or their course of study. We manage 10 competitive grant programs and produce over 30 mandated research reports for the legislature. The governor's request is $875,000 to just basically maintain what we're currently doing. That's basically an inflationary increase. Contracts get settled. If there's no money, we have to cut back on staff as pay increases go into effect. The next sheet lays out how our budget works. We have three sources of funding. About 68% of it is in the general fund. That's $467,000. About $375 million of that goes directly out the door to students in need-based aid. We have another 31% that is supported through the loan financing program. So that we do tax-exempt bonds. We give out loans, and the administrative support of that is paid for through the bond proceeds. So there's no general funds involved there. We have modest amount of licensing fees, about $1 million a year, that we get from colleges for various activities we perform for them. So this other state funds, this other 31%, $231 million, is by and large the loan funds that we get. And then finally, about 1% of our funds are, about $7 million comes through a federal grant called Get Ready. You can see that the proposed increase in expenditures by the governor, there's a $71 million in the general fund and nothing in the other two. Matter of fact, we're not sure we're gonna get re-upped on the federal grant. So if we are not re-upped, that process is going on in the next 4 or 5 months. We basically would reduce our staffing by 18 to 20 people.
Is that a fund that's been pretty consistent?
The grant is, I believe, 7 years old. It's about a seven-year-old grant. It's a national research grant where we put staff people into junior and senior highs to help students get ready to go to college, low-income students get ready for college. Okay. And we would just lose that if we don't. We're not asking for the state to pick that money up.
So you're not really, you're just being pessimistically optimistic? Let the money make.
We obviously hope that they re-up the research grant, but if they choose not to, we would.
Is that something you have to reapply for, obviously?
Yes, we're in the process of reapplying now.
Okay, all right, go ahead.
There's about, I believe, 10 or 12 states in the nation that are involved in this, and we're one of them. And it's tied to an effort to figure out the laundry list of government, of college prep programs. This is meant to try to figure out which ones work the best. And we've been part of a national study for 7 years on that. So looking at the general fund, we have 65 total employees. 22 of those are funded through the general fund. 23 are funded through basically the loan program and those licensing fees, and then the 20 federal. So the 22 are act precisely 21.4 full-time equivalents in the general fund is a little less than 1.7% of the funds. So our operating expenses, administrative funds, are a little less than 1.7% of our total funding. So it's a pretty efficient operation. We have in the last few years used 7 paid interns to basically replace 2 full-time employees. So we pay them, but we pay them less, obviously, than we would a full-time employee. And they've helped pick up some of our outreach programs and so forth. We have consolidated several positions, and we have used professional staff assigned to other activities to try to fulfill the grant applications that the legislature has given us in the last few years that we didn't used to have. We have 4 or 5 new grant programs that were given to us in the last 3 or 4 years, and we basically were given very little administrative funds, and we've reallocated professional researchers basically to run those grant programs. Then the last thing, Mr. Chairman, I wanted to point out was, along with the large request the governor has for cybersecurity, we have a $2.7 million technology request for our agency. That's our piece of this larger cybersecurity discussion. And Commissioner of Minute is here to discuss that with us. And kind of the bottom line, he's going to give us a deal, Tom Baden. The bottom line for our agency is we have about $10 million records, either loan records or state grant records, with people's Social Security numbers that we have in our databases. And we're working with a 1987 computer system called Ingress. And it's costly to run, and it's frankly not as secure as it probably should be. So we need to upgrade that system. Commissioner Baden.
Well, welcome to the committee. And are you the one that's kept that thing alive, the computer?
Mr. Chair, I feel like I have. I'm into my 35th year with the state in IT, so kind of grew up watching all these happen. And while I like vintage things, primarily vintage guitars, vintage IT, when they hit a certain point, become very dangerous. And that's what we're here to talk about today. Out of the governor's initiative.
Could you identify yourself?
Mr. Chair, my apologies. My name is Thomas A. Baden, Jr., Commissioner and State CIO for the state of Minnesota.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. My great priority for this year is to protect the data of our people in Minnesota. Each day, if you sit up in our Cybersecurity Operations Center, I can see our systems being probed over 3 million times from 150 countries. It's happening regularly. It's very real. I will happily invite any of you who want to come over and visit us at 9:30 in the morning. I get a briefing every morning. It's interesting what's happening nationally across the world, but even closer to home, a real interesting events in Ohio, Michigan, and of course what you heard in Bloomington. In the governor's budget, this piece is in there. And all the IT requests come into Minute each year, and we look at them really closely. This one could have fit in 2 categories with equal enthusiasm. All I knew it was close to the top of my priorities for the year. You're already there. All right, thank you very much. Actually, if we go back one slide for a brief moment, Just to give you a little bit of an order of magnitude, these are the number of records and the data that we protect. And if we look at cyber breaches across nationally, normally a breached record costs about $200 per record. If you add up those records, I don't want to be sitting before you with an astronomical bill at some point in the near future talking about a breach. We need to proactively act upon it. But on this, but with this, it's also a modernization effort as well. So it's kind of a combination of both of these things. It's our responsibility to provide the information technology for the commissioner to keep his business afloat. And what we're looking at here is we've got an egress database that is a vintage of 1987. The people that support that system are headed toward retirement. There aren't consultants out there that I can hire to work on this product set anymore. We've got to move that over to a modern, you know, a SQL Server, Oracle database. We've got to get it to a modern database structure. In addition, when we look at the web infrastructure and the grants for software for colleges, the IT team there, to their credit, has done a really good job of holding the system together for a long time. And actually wrapping COBOL with Cold Fusion and Visual Basic 6. All of those are older technologies. Visual Basic 6 is at its end of supported life. Cold Fusion is nearing the end of its supported life. And COBOL, while it's a tremendously robust, fast, dependable language, it's not a strategic direction we're going for long-term in the state. So what we're looking for with the request of the $1.75 million around the update of the database structure, the web infrastructure upgrades, and the state grants for colleges, I just look at these as fundamental back office underpinning technologies so the commissioner can do his job safely and securely. I support those requests. Last but not least, there's two staff that we need long-term as a part of this. We need some long-term database analyst resource as well as ADA compliance. In a nutshell, it's a fiscally responsible ask. It's an ask that the commissioner needs to run his business, and it's in the governor's budget. It's one of my priority asks for the year as well. So I thank you for your time on it today.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Is there someone on staff that actually is watching for breaches, and are you the security person that does that kind of
thing?
Yes,
sir. Yes, Mr. Chair and committee members. I've got a team of people that are watching systems all the time. One of the big positives of IT consolidation is we're able to do authenticated scans on over 50,000 devices every single day. We monitor the network. There's phishing scams through email. There's ransomware and malware. We've got a team of people watching those things.
Is the primary motive identity theft? Is that what they're looking for when they come?
It's a variety. There's a cost motivation. A lot of folks will take identities and fill out phony tax returns or even fill out phony health care claims. I mean, it's growing and expanding, and I want to get our arms around
it. We need to have tougher penalties, right,
if we
catch them.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. Any questions again? Otherwise, back to you, Commissioner.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair and committee members, thank you very much. Thank you, Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, that's all the items. We would stand for questions and try to give any backup materials that the committee might want.
Members? Did a good job. That's all I can say.
Mr. Chairman,
It's maybe the candy that sweetened them up a little bit. So.
I did this little story on this IT thing in the other body, and so I better do it here, although I was criticized in the other body. The state grant software for colleges, we basically have a person who used to work for one of the colleges who has a software system that he runs perhaps out of his basement, we're not sure, that the colleges are dependent on for processing their state grant dollars. If he passes away or decides he's no longer doing this, we have all of our colleges in the state dependent on this. And it's really something, and what I said in the other body was that I think the guy might be working in his basement in his underwear. Which may or may not
be. Scarier and scarier, yeah.
Huh?
He said scarier and scarier.
Yeah. And that may or may not be true, but that's the image here. If he just decides he's not going to do this anymore, we'd be in pretty rough shape. We need to fix that system. We need to have a software package that the state owns that it can provide to colleges. It's that simple.
We do have a question before that. Is there any candy left over there? Do you want to give it to the testifiers? And Representative Bernardi?
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you for being here, Commissioner Pogamiller. Got it right this time. Didn't call you Senator. I believe I did that last time. But my question for you is, can you share with us the progress you've made on sharing information with families and students about what college courses that are happening in our schools for concurrent enrollment and other higher education opportunities in high school are being more transparent and easier to know what's going to be transferred to a university they choose to go to?
We, Commissioner.
Thank you.
Ms. Chairman, Representative Bernardi, we would. Ms. Fergus works on that, and she supervises a paid intern to deliver on that state mandate.
Ms. Fergus, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Representative Bernardi. It's the dual credit acceptance policy survey that the commissioner is referencing. Last year, it was a mandate that OHE survey all colleges in the state of Minnesota to understand the extent to which they accept credits from post-secondary enrollment options, concurrent enrollment, advanced placement courses, international baccalaureate courses, and we added CLEP courses to the list as well, though it wasn't mandated. That survey process was undertaken this fall, and we've actually, I just received the draft yesterday about the report on which colleges have formal acceptance policies for credit transfer, where those policies are located on their websites, and what the various thresholds are that students need to meet for credit transfer. And we'll be posting all of that information on our website as well for students to use. So it's almost done.
Representative Bernardi.
Well, Ms.
Follow-up?
Chair Nornes, I would like to say the website will be up in March, but it really depends on how much other work the commissioner gives me before that.
And Bernardi? Mr. Chair, thank you. I want to thank you for doing that. I know the schools in my community and the students in our community had faced challenges with that, and I know based on how they what they communicated to me, I know that they'll be appreciative for getting that information to make some of their decisions, which will help reduce student debt because they can be planful for that and know the college that works out best for them. So thank you very much.
Representative Pryor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is really not part of the budget because you said it was the federal program that the Get Ready and that there was going to be a report on what programs were effective to get high school students ready for college. Is that something the legislature is going to hear at any point?
Commissioner?
Ms. Chairman, we can dig out what the federal reports look like. We report to them, and why don't we'll pull some things out and forward that to you.
Okay. More questions? You did well.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. Committee members, thank you. And please feel free to ask any detailed questions that you need us to provide for you. Try to answer them. Thank you.
All right. Chair will move House File 889 be held over for possible inclusion. I guess that's about the end of our... we have one more guest.
I'll make it as quick as I can.
All right. We have time.
You asked for an update on the... You asked for an update on the stadium issue that came last...
Identify Thursday. Yourself and...
Oh, record. Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. And
welcome, Mark.
Thank you, committee members, chair and owners. You had asked me earlier in the day about an update on the stadium issue that came up last Thursday, I believe it was. And... they do have a Senate file for House File 778. It was supposed to be heard today in House GovOps. It wasn't heard because of the public safety bill and the governor's budget that got talked about. But it will be heard again on Thursday in Room 10 on February 16th. I will attend that one. What I'm referring to last Thursday is they brought Mr. Mondale and his executive director to the stand on a joint Senate and House hearing. Yeah, and on Senator Rosen's request on some misuse of funds and tickets. Turns out that Mr. Mondale was given 350 tickets that he then paid for later on, and there was $31,000 or $32,000 in liquor spent. Now, the reason I bring this up is because I looked in Appendix F, and it'll tell you who the guests were, and you can certainly, if you have time, which I don't know that you do, maybe you do, can look, but there were some University of Minnesota officials and ex-officials there. And where we hear a lot of testimony from time to time in this committee from the University of Minnesota, of which I'm proudly alumni, I think it might at some point be pertinent in one issue or another. And I think the whole thing is a mess. And to be quite honest, I'm upset about it, so I'm going to follow it through. But my opinions don't really matter, but I just wanted to bring it to the committee's attention. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Hughes. Hearing no other business, it's about almost 10 after 4, and hope you've got something to do, because we're all done.